看一下。The Almighty God.I will tell the world I've been born again. I will tell the world I know a man that can make it all right. I know a man that can make people put down guns. I know a man that can take guns out of the hands.And his name is Jesus. 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 Sometimes we forget.Pray to worship the Lord. Worship God in spirit and in truth. Worship God with all you have. People walk around and they forget that if it wasn't for God,we wouldn't even be here. God is a loving God. But God is also a God that will get tired of our mess. We don't believe he has illness. We don't want God to totally take his hands off of his job. But God is tired of what this worldThe United States, we turn away from God. And then we cry when things start to happen. This is a world that God made. God made us. We don't even belong to ourselves. And here we are around here, don't want to praise and worship God.How would your living Father here on earth feel if you didn't want to say, hey, Dad, or hey, Mom? So what do you think, God? Praise the Lord. This morning, we are just glorifying God. All right. Amen. Number one, we are alive.
Amen.
All the people we've seen killed.In these last 2 weeks.
Yes, Lord.
Something's got to be done.
Yes, Lord.
God has had it in my heart for the last 2 or 3 months. Those of you that's been here regular know that I've been telling everybody it's time to turn back to God. You know, we got to realize this, y'all. We can't do nothing without God.
Amen.
A gun is not going to help you do nothing.You can pick that gun up and God let your heart quit beating.
Right.
You can pick that gun up and God let it misfire.
Yes.
The gun ain't nothing. It's God was in your heart.
All right.
We've got to show that respect to our Father. When I was coming up as a boy in my daddy's house,If my mother said she was going to tell my dad, I cried like a baby. So what do you think happens when God is looking at us doing mess? Don't we know God gets tired of us?
Right.
But he still loves us.
Yes.
He loves us so much that he give us a way back to him. God came down to this earth in fleshly form to save old crazy us.
Right.
He loved us that much, Mother Carter,
yes,
that he came down, gave up, took a life in flesh, gave up that fleshly life so that what? We could be saved.
All right.
So therefore, we should be happy to praise and worship God.
Amen.
Why should we worship God? You know, I told you last time we were going to stay on this subject, because we need to know why we worship God, and we need to worship God at all times.
Amen.
I tell you, when we say worship God in spirit and in truth, you know, God has done so much for us. I worship God for everything he's done for me.
Amen.
You know, he woke me up this morning. He let me be able to see you all.
Amen.
He let you be able to see me. Now, don't you know we should praise God for that?
Amen.
We should have all been hollering, hallelujah.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
For God is worthy to be praised, to be worshipped, to be loved.
Amen.
Why should we worship God? To worship is to show reverence and adoration for a deity or to something that represents a deity. People worship all kinds of things. I think you all know this. They worship the true God. That's John 4:24. Some people even worship demons. Revelation 9 and 20. They worship carvings or statues made to represent beasts. You don't believe me? Go to Exodus 32, 7 and 8. People worship the sun, the moon, the stars. They worship kings. And some of us worship ourselves, including our own carnal appetites. Some of those appetites, some of you know what those things are, so I won't go into that. The first occurrence of the word worship in the Bible is in Genesis 22 and 5. In that passage, Abraham and Isaac are headed up the hill to the altar where Abraham planned to sacrifice Isaac in obedience to God's command. This was a test of Abraham's faith. God never meant for him to sacrifice his son. And it is interesting that Abraham says to his servants, "Stay here while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you." Clearly, Abraham thought of his obedience in this manner as an act of adoration or worship. And it is also interesting that he spoke in the plural, "We will come back." Even when he knew that God had commanded him to kill Isaac on the altar. Now I tell you what, that's faith. That's having faith in God. That's having a trust and belief in God, that if God tells you something, I said this earlier before some of you got here, if God take you to it, he's definitely going to take you through it.
All right. Yes, he will.
So therefore, we have to stand on God's word.
Right.
A relationship with God naturally produces worship. You can't worship God if you don't know him. Amen.
Amen.
But if you know God, then you can worship him. See, God tests us, church. He challenges us. He saves us. He showers us with gifts. He provides for us. And God protects us. He is intimately involved in our lives. And in return, what do we supposed to do? We praise and adore him. We worship him. See, true worship is not forced or put on you harshly. True worship flows naturally from us toward the one who controls our life and destiny. I'm going to say that again. God controls our life and our destiny. See, we don't control none of that. But God does. See, since God is in control, if your finances get a little tight, remember God is in control. So we just start praising him and glorifying him. You know, start telling him, God, I love you. Lord, I thank you. I know you're going to make a way for us. Why should we worship God? Why is it imperative to worship him alone instead of statues or the moon or ourselves? In the end, the why of worship is about trust. Whom do you trust? Do you trust me? Terrell, you trust the hubby? Hubby, you trust Terrell? Or do you trust God? All right. See, one of y'all one day going to have to go wait a minute. But God is always going to be there for you. You can always do what? Turn to God. You can always say, Lord, have mercy. And the Lord will have mercy. And you know, that's enough right there. I don't need to say no more. That's enough right there to say, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
You know, I worship you. I praise you. I glorify you. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
One of the worst was King David. But in the end, the why of worship is about trust. Whom do we trust? King David wrote of some good reasons to praise and worship God. And you know, King David, he'd be out there doing some everything. But he had sense enough to come back and ask God for forgiveness. David wrote of some good reasons to praise and worship God. He is the maker of heaven and earth. We wouldn't even have nowhere to stay, would we? If it wasn't,
right.
Wasn't for the Lord.
Amen.
He's the maker of the sea and everything in the sea. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow. But he frustrates the ways of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever. Why do we worship God? Well, God is the only one worth worshiping. He alone deserves worship because he alone is good. He alone can give salvation in him alone. Nobody else can save you but God.
Right.
Nobody.
Amen.
You know, the only thing the devil can help you do is go to hell.
All right.
Devil can't save. But thank God for God.
Amen.
Because he loves us so much that he can and will save you. You know, when you have problems and stuff is going rough And you can't talk to your husband. You can't talk to your wife. You can't talk to your big sister. You can talk to God. And I tell you what, he's such a wonderful God that the lady or the man down the street or the people around the corner ain't going to know your business.
Amen.
Ain't nobody going to know it but you and God.
Amen.
Folks will be wondering, well, how did they do this? We didn't do nothing. God did.
Amen.
What is this that makes me want to shout? What is this that opened up my eyes? What is this that heals me when the doctors say there is no healing?
All right.
His name is Jesus.
Okay. Amen.
Jesus the Christ. Jesus the mighty God. See, when you have him in your life, you actually now become a real person. You live a real life. You have real changes in your life. And you become stronger in your faith in God.
All right.
See, when God does something, everybody don't know.
Amen.
A lot of us, when something happened, I heard a fellow say, yeah, if I win that money, I ain't gonna tell nobody. If he had won that money, he'd told everybody. But see, God is such a God that he does what we really need.
All right.
When you are sick and your doctor said there's no cure, you can call on God.
All right.
Because he'll come tomorrow. He'll come this evening.
Right.
You can go into the doctor's office and he say, well, you need this or you need that. You can walk outside and say, Lord, have mercy. And you walk back in there and the doctor will wonder, where did it go?
All right.
God took it away. All we got to do, y'all, is just worship the Lord. Praise God. Thank him for what he's done for us.
Right.
You know, if something happened in your life, tell the world about it. Don't be ashamed. Let everybody know God did this for me. A lot of times I don't know about you, but I walk out and put my hand on my vehicle and I say, thank you, Jesus. Because without you, I wouldn't even have it. I may go touch my house. I say, thank you, Jesus. Because I know without you, I wouldn't have had it. I even sometimes, Brother Cooper, have to touch my wife. I say, thank you, Jesus.
Because
if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't have no money. The other day I was thinking about my job and situations on the job, and the devil will say, well, you ought to go and cut it loose. You ought to go and quit. You know, you old enough now, go and retire. I had to tell the devil, brother, I said, the Lord gave it to me. So why am I going to quit what God gave me?
All right.
Because if he gave it to me, he going to bless me on it, ain't he? Hallelujah. He didn't just give me something to give me something. He knew I had a need, and he knew how long that need would be. So he fixed a way for me to take care of. Some of us were walking around and we were wondering, well, the preacher talking about praise the Lord, worship the Lord.
That's right.
How can I please God? Brother Chamberlain was telling me about this song. You don't love God. What is
wrong with you?
What's wrong with you? But I love the Lord. But I'm going to tell you this. We ask, well, how can I please God? Pleasing God, church, is or should be the goal of all believers. All who call upon the name of Christ for salvation.
That's right.
The requirements for all who want to please God are that they must seek God by faith, walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh, and walk worthy of our calling in obedience and submission to the will of God. These things to us may seem impossible to do, But God wants us to please Him.
All right.
And He makes it possible for us to please Him. We do these things by the power of His Spirit who lives in our hearts.
Amen.
Not on your own.
Amen.
Paul reminded the believers in Rome that they who are in the flesh cannot please God. I'll say that again to you. They who are in the flesh cannot please God. You can read that in Romans 8 and 8. So the first step in pleasing God is to accept the sacrifice for sin that He provided in the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. Only then are we in the Spirit and not in the flesh. We do this by faith because without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to God must believe that God exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. How many of you today can truly say that you seek the Lord? Hello. I'm here today to tell you, if you're not seeking Him, you better start.
All right.
If you see all these things happening around you, the only one that can save you and deliver you is the Lord.
All right. Amen.
So seek the Lord at all times.
Amen.
Not just today in church, but when you're at home by yourself or when you're on your job, seek the Lord. Call on the name of the Lord. In Romans 8, Paul explains the difference between the sinful nature and the nature of those generated by the Spirit. Those who are still in their sin have their minds set on sinful desires, whereas the ones regenerated by Christ have a completely new mind that is controlled by the Spirit and desire to live in accordance with Him. The mind of sinful man is what? Death. But the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. So the first step for believers in pleasing God is to be sure we are walking in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Furthermore, we Christians, we those believers of God, we must live by faith. God cannot be pleased with those who shrink back and get afraid because there's no fear in God. People that fall back of fear have really no confidence in God, or they doubt the truth of His declarations and promises. Or who do not believe that His ways are right and holy and perfect. The requirement of faith and confidence in God is not unreasonable. It is just what we require of our children and our spouses, right? And it is an indispensable condition of our being pleased with them. So it is with God. With your children, you look for a certain thing from them. If you say don't do that, you look for them not to do that. If you love your wife and your wife loves you, then you all are trying to do things to show care and love for each other. Same thing with God. God loves us. And He looks for us to show Him reverence. Amen.
Right. Amen.
Therefore, pleasing God is a matter of living according to His precepts, commandments, and doing so in love. We always want to please those we love, right?
Amen.
And the New Testament is full of exhortations to righteous living and loving Christ by obeying His commandments. Jesus made this very plain when He said, if you love me, will obey what I command. John 14:15. The epistles are God's plan for believers and are filled with exhortations to display throughout our lives the behavior that is pleasing to God. For the rest then, my brothers, we beseech you and exhort you in the Lord Jesus, that as you have received from us how you ought to walk and to please God, so you will abound more and more. You can find that in 1 Thessalonians 4:1.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I tell you this today. Worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Praise the Lord for all that he has done for you. You know, we just do not give God enough praise.
Amen.
You know, we as individuals, we praise our brother and sister, we praise mom and daddy, but we forget who Big Daddy is.
Mm-hmm.
His name is Jesus. We don't give God the praise. I saw a house over in 8 Mile that says, God gave me this house. A sign out in their yard. Not saying you do that, but the more you praise God, the more God will bless you. The more you worship the Lord, the more the Lord will turn loose blessings on you. Amen.
Amen.
It's a true fact. I used to wonder about that. Why is it that I used to hear my mother say, when praises go up, blessings come down?
Right.
Y'all, I'm here today to tell you that is a fact. You start praising the Lord and worshiping the Lord, letting other folks know that the Lord did this for me. The Lord moved this out of my way. God straightened this out on my job. Start just praising God like that. Start watching what God will do. Don't take my word. Just read the word of the Lord, where he tells you to have faith in God. That if you have faith, you can do what? You can speak to yonder mountain, and yonder mountain will move to rest. Speak to it in the name of Jesus. And I keep saying this over and over to all of you. If God bring you to that situation, don't you know God's going to take you through it?
All right.
He didn't bring you there to leave you there.
Yes, Lord.
He brought you there to show you, I am God.
Yes.
I can fix anything. I can do all things. Trust in me with all your heart. Don't lean to your crazy understanding.
All right,
you thinking something is this and something is that when I already know what it is. See, the wonderful thing about our God is, Brother Cooper, God sees from the end to the beginning.
All right,
we look at stuff from the beginning and wonder what's going to happen in the end. But see, God already has seen the end, and he's looking from the end to the beginning. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What a mighty God we serve.
That's right.
Can't nobody do nothing without him. Can't nobody do nothing to who he cares about.
All right.
We just got to believe and have faith in him. Trust the Lord. You know, you see me out there a lot of times when Brother Chambers playing that music and I'm dancing. I'm worshiping God and I'm praising the Lord. For I know, if it hadn't have been for God, where I'd be, all of the things that I've done, and God forgave me, all the things I've done, bro, and God still promoted me, Lord have mercy.
Amen.
I'll tell you, he's a mighty God. He's a God that loves, because he is love. God loves all of us. Each and every one of us. Those of us that have parents, we know how our parents treat us and have treated us. And how when I can remember when my father said something, that's what he meant.
All right, man.
Right.
You know, so same thing with our Father God. If God's word says it,
that's it.
If the word says that God so loved the world, put your hands on it, put your mind on it, put your eyes on it, because he loves you. Even when you turn away from God, Brother Cooper, God still loves us. Even when we act like we forgot what time church starts and why we ain't getting there every Sunday and the pastor won't call us, God still loves us.
Amen.
God still knows what's happening in our lives. And he's such a loving God. Even when we needed the job, God gave it to us. Already knowing we may not do what we're supposed to do. But he loved us so much, Mother Carter, that he still worked things out. God is such a God that all you got to do is call on him. Lord, have mercy. You don't have to say a prayer for 15, 20 minutes. All you got to do is call on and say, Lord, have mercy.
Amen.
Meaning it from your heart.
Amen.
Because, see, God knows your heart.
Yes,
you know, we may try to trick or fool God, but I'm here today to tell you, it don't work, y'all. You've got to be for real with God. And if you are for real with God, God will do things that the world ain't never seen happen before. That car that you need. You may walk out to the place and the man say, well, you don't need but X amount of dollars. You may not have that. You go to your job and somebody says, you know, I've been watching you and the way you work. We're going to give you a raise. And your raise be for the same amount of money that you need for your car. Hallelujah. I tell you, I've seen God do things that nobody else could do. Going into a hospital room and a lady sent home and the doctors told the lady that she might as well go on home. They called her family. You have 1 week to live. I got to the lady's house, Brother Cooper. She said, I hope you didn't come out here looking for me to die. She said, because the Lord ain't told me that. I said, ma'am, don't nobody know when you're going to leave this world but God. I came out here to encourage you and to pray with you for God's will to be done in your life. And when you go to God, what does the scripture say? And everybody during these times that we're going through right now should be definitely reading this scripture in the book of 2 Chronicles. Second Chronicles 7. This one Solomon was talking to. When the Lord was talking to Solomon, but it applies to us now. All of the things that we see happening and the world is going through. This holds true for us right today. Second Chronicles 7, starting in verse 12. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, suppose you all, suppose my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Those are strong words, church. The Lord is letting us know right there in his word, if we humble ourselves and come to him, talk to the Lord about it. In other words, if I humble myself, meaning if I repent of my sins and I come to the Lord and I'm praying, talking to God, asking God to forgive me for my sins, which the United States and all other people of the world should be doing right now, asking God to forgive us of our sins. The Lord said he'll heal the man.
Yes, he will.
He'll forgive our sins. So what's the problem? What is the problem? God has told us what he'll do. Do you believe God? If you believe God, then do that. And watch what God does for us. I don't know about you, but I want to be blessed. I want to have finances. I want to have my eyesight. I want to be able to walk. I want to be able to talk. All these things the Lord has told me he'll heal if I humble myself. So I'm asking you to do the same thing.
Amen.
Just go to your word and read your word daily. Read the word of 7 Chronicles 7:14 or 7:12. And ask God to forgive you of your sins. And remember, whatever situation that you're in, that God is in there with you.
Yes, he is.
And God will bring you out.